I made the script after the Owl House finale. Much like the rest of Season 3 and Season 2B, the finale took a lot of inspiration from the Amphibia finale. I went down a rabbit hole of supposed good Disney anime.
Amphibia was a perfect successor, and arguably the best attempt at making a true successor.
What about the Owl House?
Owl House?
So true!
The point is, the show stuck with its plan from the start to end. They set up everything right in that first episode, but also every element in the finale is established long before the finale. Something that a specific other Disney show really can't say.
Now wait, before you click off this video after leaving a mean comment, hear me out. I've been trying to approach this video for a while now, and it truly is a video that motivated me to make this whole animation series. I've watched The Owl House now 3 times. Once when it originally aired, once when I was originally planning to make this video, and once just before writing the script. And each time I came out with a different opinion. The first time I enjoyed the show, but hated its finale. The problem with that opinion, though, that I hadn't thought it through. Remember, the 3-part finale came out over 6 months, and I didn't rewatch anything going into the episode. I had forgotten basically the entire show, not only going into the finale, but between each step. So when I watched it again the second time, my opinion became a bit more negative. I really didn't like it my second time through, because I watched it in direct comparison to Amphibia. I literally watched the two in their entirety back to back, and that's when I really began noticing the flaws in the show. The bigger problem, though, is that I was only half paying attention during that rewatch, as I was playing games while watching it, and I had taken lazy notes. So a year later, when I had sat down to write down the script, I realized that wasn't going to cut it for an unbiased review. So I went down and I watched the entire 17-hour show in its entirety, with no breaks, no distractions, just the show. And surprisingly, I came back with almost the same exact issues. However, it was less negative. I've retitled this video 3 times because of that. The first title is what I would change about The Owl House, but I felt that wasn't a good representation of what the video was about. Then I changed it to The Owl House, Overrated and Rushed, but that felt a bit too harsh. And then, the current title. This one fits my opinion the most. The Owl House is the show that started strong and had very strong direction and theming, and then it all came crashing down. Character consistency went out the window, characters were being sidelined, the story was rushed, and while I know the context behind all of that was a cancellation, in order for this to be an unbiased review, I can't take that into consideration. I have to go into the show as someone who has no idea about the behind-the-scenes drama, or the way the show came out. And looking at it from that perspective, I don't think it holds up well. But before we critique the show, let's talk about the good parts, because there are a lot of good things about the show. But before we begin, just like the last one, obvious spoiler warnings. Like, the show is best watched blind. You have been warned. First off, I want to say that I enjoyed the plotline the show was trying to go for and trying to set up. It had me very intrigued and it was a very interesting premise. I especially enjoyed Season 2A. That has to be the best part of the show. It was really playing off what Season 1 set up and furthering the plot along. Characters felt like they were actually being developed and everything felt consistent. As well, I really enjoyed the main cast of characters. It was a fun time watching them grow throughout their journey, and while I don't feel as strong as a connection to them as the cast of other shows like Amphibia or Gravity Falls, these characters are still very strong, and were one of the main reasons I was able to sit through this show. I love the way they can play off each other so well, and their dynamics are fantastic. Luz and Amity, for example, they have some of the best on-screen chemistry I've seen out of all three of these shows. They play off each other so well, and unlike a certain other show... Go away! It doesn't feel forced. And it works really well within the show. I also think the animation in the show is phenomenal. I have some clips playing right now. While both Amphibia and Gravity Falls had their moments, The Owl House blows both of them out of the water. As every episode has some memorable moments where the animation just went crazy. Besides that, there isn't much I can say, but I enjoyed what I enjoyed about the show, and I really wish I had more to say. But I don't. Let's get on to our first talk point, the messy structure. Alright, to get an example of what I mean, let's compare Titan Luz to Calamity Ann. Right out the first episode, we know something happened with the stones and the humans. In the intro, we see there's 3 flashes of lights of 3 different colors. Each human gets covered by a color of light, and it switches between the 3 colors. And in the very first episode, Anne's eyes quickly flash blue as she defends her new friend Sprig, which notably is a color of one of the gems on the box. This establishes the special powers very early in the show, allowing Anne to have a payoff moment that establishes this during the finale where all 3 of them are super powered up. Luz, on the other hand, is given absolutely nothing. There is no Titan in the first episode, not even a minor appearance. Like, yes, the Boiling Isles is the Titan, But his first full appearance is in the second episode, and the word Titan isn't even said until the second to last episode of season one.
Any way to respect what the Titan gave us?
You can go back and fact check me, but I made sure that that was correct, because they don't just throw it around until season two.
Calamity Ann is definitely a moment in Amphibia that feels very earned, because it's introduced and teased in that very first episode, and it's resolved throughout both season two finale and the season three finale. It's a moment that they were always building up to, and it was something that was very clearly always in the plan for the show. Titan Lose does not feel like a moment like that. Titan Lose just kind of comes out of nowhere, because as just said, Titans pretty much mean nothing until the latter half of season 2. Like, sure, the word Titan is said for the first time in the latter half of season 1, but at that point, all we know is that Titans are considered gods. We don't even know, realistically, what a Titan is besides the Boiling Isles was a Titan at one point. Season 2 is when they fully introduce Titans as a creature, and we learn that King is a Titan. And that's the first time the word Titan means anything. Lose getting Titan powers doesn't resolve anything. There is an arguably better route to take that would have made way more sense for the direction the show was going in, and would have actually been satisfying.
Lose mastering the glyphs. Mastering the glyphs truly would be the best way to fulfill her arc, but sadly they went a different route. This issue isn't mutually exclusive to just this one thing. It appears all the time for the way the finale plays out to the Titan itself. What the resulting effect does is that it takes away from the feeling that the moment was earned, because it wasn't. It was just thrown in to have a cool moment. But the cool moment could have been cooler and made more sense in the grand scheme of things. Even the Star Versus of All Shows got this right. Kinda. With the exception of the destroying all magic plotline, pretty much every major character and ability was set up within the first X episodes. So, while the actual plot of the finale is bad, they still used a lot of the elements set up early on. It was just bad.
Alright, I feel the need to explain myself, because otherwise I'm gonna get flamed in the comments. What I mean by this is, like, elements such as Star's butterfly form, the magic rub, Glossaris being made out of magic. Like, when you look at it, a lot of the stuff was set up very early on. It's just the way they used it was just not how they set it up, and there was other stuff that they left out, but they still set up 99% of everything that they were using in the finale before the finale. It's just not great payoff, but yeah, that's what I mean by they did it, but kind of, not really.
Going to Amphibia, as mentioned in that previous video, everything is set up within the first episode, so why couldn't the Owl House do the same? It is one of the core aspects of storytelling to make sure your themes, messages, and plotlines are all consistent and established from the start, and I just don't feel like the Owl House was able to do that. Plotlines like the Titans still being somewhat alive, Titans themselves, Collector, Hunter, the Widowbane, with the exception of the Day of Unity, none of those are payoff of these things introduced in Season 1. It's all Season 2 stuff. Yes, other shows like Amphibia introduced a lot of elements of its finale in Season 2 and 3, however, unlike was the case with the Owl House, not only does pretty much every season 1 episode have some major role to play in the build-up to the finale, from Kratonio the Nuke to Domino 2, a lot of the things that season 2 introduced was building off of elements introduced in 1. For instance, the cast system, the toads, and toxic friendship, everyone's character role. It's all introduced in that first episode. Even the core and the prophecy, you pause the intro right when the title card comes on and
boom! There's the prophecy, there's the Calamity Trio, there's the core, all right there in the intro of that very first episode.
Now, while I do think the character development was strong, by season 2B, it became apparent that they didn't know how to continue with their resolved arcs. So what did they do? This one was not an issue at the start of the show. In fact, if you go back to seasons 1 and 2A, the characters have very clear development. And then you get to season 2B. This is when the show started to lose the plot a bit and went back on character growth. For instance, looking at episode 18, Amity out of nowhere begins to doubt Willow's ability, even though by this point it's basically been assumed that she and Willow had worked things out. Why now of all episodes they decided to put the plotline in just beats me, but fine. Let's say they weren't all good. The way they approach this obstacle in the episode is by Amity haphazardly saying, "I just got you back as a friend and I need to protect you." And Willow responding back, No, you just need to see me for who I really am. And then off screen they make up and all of a sudden the problem just goes away. I hate bringing up Amphibia so much in this episode, but they have very similar plot lines. Here, this directly parallels with Marcy at the Gate. Anne and Marcy go through a very similar type of problem. However, the way it's resolved makes sense. Anne and Marcy have a heartfelt discussion, and Anne puts her trust in Marcy. They do actual action to make sure things go well, and it isn't just two lines that get resolved off screen. The same thing actually happens again with Sasha in season 3, and it's resolved the same way. Here, right after it seems like they're about to work things back, it cuts back to the other characters, and this plotline just gets resolved. Another plotline was with Hunter. His arc is pretty consistent throughout.
He befriends the witches, saves them a few times, but constantly betrays their trust. He has his entire reality shattered after going through Belle's mind. He works with the witches again and earns their trust back.
And then after some time spent in the human world, Ramos has been, he says something along the lines of,
"It's not like I don't want to go back. I just need a way to pass the time." And that's all. You see, the way he says that, it's like, "Oh, I didn't want to do that at all. No, no, no." It's like, "You sure about that?" It's so obvious he's trying to hide something here, but it's never followed up on again.
It somewhat felt like a natural progression of his arc, seeing as he doesn't really consider himself a witch anymore and he's a clone of a human. So that seems like an interesting thing to follow up on, but they just completely ignore it. As well, he just gets sidelined in the next two episodes, being used for other people's arcs, when he just lost his closest friend, Flapjack. They briefly touch on it. But it was a plot thread that needed more time to cook in the oven, because it was half-baked at best. They had an entire opportunity as Hunter as a way to deal with grief, but they instead ignore him. As well, in that same episode, Willow suddenly has been bottling up all her emotions. Another interesting plot thread. However, it comes out of nowhere. Maybe it was supposed to be set up in the original version of season 3, but the whole plotline kind of feels forced, like they didn't know what to do with their characters. So they just crammed a ton of shit into one episode. As well, there are many characters who just completely went underutilized. The Blight Twins never really got any major development. They were starting something right at the end of season 2B with the whole, wrestling episode. I forget what it's called, but it never went anywhere. As well, characters like Odalia were just wasted in the finale. She was one of the few characters shown to be explicitly not turned into a toy like the others. However, they don't use that to do anything with her character. They don't try and redeem her. They don't try and make her even more redeemable. She's just there, and it really was a waste of a character. Chekhov's gun. You don't establish something and ignore it, alright? You either put it there or you don't. Even so, they doubled down on characters who already had completed arcs, like Kikimora or Willow. Characters who had become the best versions of themselves, but because they were used more, characters like Gus or Hunter never got a completed arc. They both had setups for something truly amazing, but it never gets followed up on. Instead, both are sidelined and are used as a way to further Willow's character arc. Honestly, I could talk about that whole episode. It arguably the worst in the entire show. This was such a waste of an episode. Season 3 was 3 episodes long. Each one was an hour. So like any reasonable show, you're saying that this time was spent doing something important. I mean, that's what Amphibia did. That's what Gravity Falls did. That's what usually happens during a finale. Sadly, there is only one word I can use to describe this episode. Filler. Filler! In a finale! This really, really showed just how much the show is falling apart. Firstly, the episode actually opens up pretty strong, showing what happens immediately after the season 2 finale and how things developed. As well, the ending was pretty solid, setting up things nicely for the final episode. The problem is, that was all for the B plot, and as such, most of it was relegated to a few minutes here or there. Instead, we follow our main cast as they discover the Resistance base and being run by Kikimora. Fucking Kikimora! Instead of using this episode to continue from the highs of the previous episode, by continuing Hunter's plotline, giving Luz some extra development, and exploring more of Philip Woodbane's past, because we are still mostly in the dark about that, even after the show has ended. All of that was set up in the last episode, but we instead go back to focusing on Willow, Kikimora, and the other side characters. The problem with that is that we don't have time to mess around like that. This should have been set up much earlier and given much more time to develop. Amphibia set up these episodes well. None of them felt like filler except for Spryby. For instance, when the Alder Whirlers' past were reintroduced, they actually served an important purpose. They helped the humans build connections with the Olms and got the prophecy delivered to them. as well in cases like Tritonia or Domino 2. They were used to build up the resistance, giving it more strength. Here, Kiyomura is just there because she wants power. But if we're being honest, that just does not make sense for finale plotline. First off, Kiyomura should have been written out of the show much earlier, but she was given an opportunity to flee. Imagine if the Gravity Falls finale, instead of having the episode Gravity Falls called Take Back the Falls, they made an episode where they had the Mystery Shack resistance base, and it was run by Robbie, controlling Pacifica as a puppet leader into making bad decisions for the army, instead of what we actually got, where they introduce the army, where they waste no time, and immediately begin working on a plan to take out Bell Cipher. What a waste of time! We don't need this, especially in the context of the show, as it's not like the resistance even matters. They did nothing. This is the only episode they appear in, as in the next episode, they're all captured anyways. Meaning, they were introduced with no build-up or setup, their only purpose was to exist in one episode. This episode is arguably the worst in the show, because it's just a waste of time. 99% of the episode could have been skipped. Because they forced in a few good plot lines in, you can't. I don't think any other episode of The Alice can truly be just labeled as bad. Sure, there are unimportant episodes or just regular filler, but this isn't just filler. It's filler in an already rushed finale.
I need water after that. Holy fuck.
The finale is an episode that sealed the deal for me. Not because it was bad, but because it was underwhelming. I've talked about this in the other section, but the finale didn't pay off anything. A good finale should not only leave a lasting impact on the audience, but tie up all unresolved character arcs and recontextualize the entire show. Both Amphibia and Gravity Falls pull that off, because the seeds were all planted in the first episode. We can go back to those early episodes and say it was building up to this. Another show I'd like to bring up here is Transformers Prime. Transformers Prime was Hasbro's new definitive modern take on the Transformers, and in that regard, even if you don't like it, it most certainly succeeded. The sad thing about the show is, however, that it was very costly. The execs and the showrunners did not get along, and they were constantly going over budget. So, Hasbro gave them one last shorter season, and pulled the plug. In that shorter season, they wasted absolutely no time. They managed to resolve almost every unresolved plot thread, while still introducing new ones, while wrapping the series up in a nice bow. You can see that it fit within their plan, and the show felt like it was meant to end the way it did, even though it really wasn't. Spoiler warning. Skipped it this time to avoid it, but by the end of the finale, it isn't Optimus who defeats Megatron. It's a scout, Bumblebee. He was tortured by Megatron, hurt, even killed. By falling into this well, he was fully repaired and defeats his greatest enemy. He then restores Cybertron with the humans they've protected, and they go see the restored Cybertron. Ratchet, the medic, stays on Earth. There's technically one more episode movie that furthers everyone's arcs, and again, it does not invalidate previous arcs, and it even ends with Optimus sacrificing himself to restore life to Cybertron. It pays off every arc, and it leaves a satisfying ending, while recontextualizing the rest of the show. Rewatching the show allows you to pick up on everything that sets these characters up for their eventual final places. With the Owl House, everything just kinda comes out of nowhere. The Collector ends up having a full-on redemption arc after going full nightmare mode on everyone, and it's shown that the Collector have no concept of death, which works, but could have been introduced earlier. Eventually, Belos gets the idea to possess a Titan, and one thing leads to another, and Luz sacrifices herself to save the Collector. Then, the Titan's confirmed to not be fully dead. Luz has a conversation with the Titan, gets a power boost, they win, they save, time skip, all of that. The problem is, it doesn't feel earned. Nothing feels right about the way it plays out. From Luz's sacrifice first speaking with the Titan, it just doesn't flow well narrative. We know Luz would sacrifice to protect her friend. She does it multiple times throughout the show, but that's the problem. It's predictable, and that's not really a finale moment. It's trying to be some big reveal or an emotional moment, but all three times, watching, I'm yet to even shed a tear. It just does not work. The problem is the sacrifice moment is needed for the show, and only to fully turn the Collector. Luz just isn't the right character for it, because she doesn't even have a relationship with the Collector. Arguably, the role would have fit King much better. Let me explain. King has a character arc in the show, but there could have been an even better one. King's arc in the show is about identity and family. The entire time he's searching for his family and trying to find out what he is, and we never truly see how it finishes. Imagine he made the sacrifice, he got to speak with his dad, and he got the power boost from the Titan. It would have made for a much more impactful moment, and he would have definitely aided one of the many problems I have with the finale. It works as a payoff for both his identity crisis and a search for the family, as well as a search for power and friends. It also pays off the setup with King and the Collector. Luz and the Collector hadn't even met until the start of the finale, whereas King and the Collector had been hanging out exclusively since the season finale. King was the reason the rest of the cast weren't immediately killed. It was King who wanted to save the Collector. It would have been fit best for not only King's arc, but narratively for the Collector, as it would have really hammered in the mortality for the Collector, and as George Lucas says,
yeah, it's like poetry, sort of, they rhyme.
As it was King's father who trapped the Collector. It would have been really poetic for to save the Collector. It could have been a real payoff, and while I still think Luz should be the one to defeat Bilas in the end, imagine an actual fight through with all three of them at max power. Still, that doesn't fix every problem I have with it. The finale only addresses Luz and the Collector, despite the fact Eden and King are in it. They do practically nothing. They do no wrong, they just kind of fight. We don't even get to see the rest of the main cast until a few seconds after Luz dies. Normally that isn't a problem, but it becomes an issue when the progression is still unfinished. The finale can't even wrap up every loose end. Is it even a finale? Watching this finale left me wanting more. Not because I wanted more of these characters in the world, but because I wanted an actual filling conclusion for the show that had so much potential. The Outlaws of the show, I wanted to love so badly, and I went in thinking it was going to be one of my favorite shows of all time, and it would be on par, if not better, than both Gravity Falls and Amphibian. But in my honest opinion, just falls flat. I am aware of the cancellation and the context surrounding why the ending turned out the way it did, but even with the context, I don't think it holds up. There are plenty of examples of cancelled shows or budgets being cut that produce a satisfying and complete ending that leaves no stone unturned. Look at Transformers Prime, for instance. It completely finishes every important arc. I understand they were setting up something with Ragnarok here, but they didn't have time for that, and they knew it. And so while it was missed potential, it's not like it messed up the show or the pacing. It was just a missed opportunity. I understand why you could love the show. There is so much to love about it. But in my opinion, the show's flaws just cause the entire show to fall flat on its face. It's just not as good as the other shows, like many people say it is. And I know I'm gonna get a lot of hate for this video, but I don't care. My opinions are my opinions, and your opinions are your opinions. If you disagree with me, which I know a lot of you probably do, please critique my points in the comments. I want to see other perspectives. That's why I'm making this video, to share my perspective. Even if you disagree with my point, I hope you enjoyed this video and you join me next week to see the conclusion to this, where I talk about the rise and fall of kids' animation.
Alright, so normally this is a section of the video where I have an end screen up and I cut to a meme, but I'm not doing that this time. And instead, I'm going to clarify a few points. So first and foremost, this is probably going to be one of the most confusing parts of the video that I didn't address. But in the intro of this video and all the other videos, I showed a clip where I said that the Owl House took a lot of inspiration from the Amphibia finale. And I said that, implying that the Owl House copied Amphibia. And it doesn't matter what I think on that or not. I think it's just a stupid point. Because it's just unnecessary to bring up. It doesn't add anything to the conversation. And in the end, like, what the fuck does it matter? Like, I don't know. I shouldn't have brought it up. I kept it in this video because it worked with, like, the stream of cliffs bashing the Owl House that you couldn't tell. But, that was really, like, something that what I wasn't going to talk about. And I'm not going to talk about it. Second, I wanted to talk about, like, the cancellation here. Because I didn't really want to dedicate a part of the video to it. But here's right now, I think, is the perfect spot to talk about it. So, one of the biggest things with cancellation, I saw, is that none of the problems I have with the show are a result of the cancellation, right? Filler in a finale is not a result of a cancellation, it's a result of poor planning. Doubling down on completed arcs is not a result of a cancellation, it's a result of poor planning, right? And I think that's the biggest factor, is that the Owl House was a poorly planned show. You look at Transformers Prime, for instance, it's around the same length, when you take into account structure and all that, it's got, like, the same situation where the last season was cut in half. Because when you do the math with the Owl House, like, in total, they had enough time for around 9 episodes in a normal length. But it's because it's all hours long, it's like, it's 3 episodes. But, Transformers Prime also had a half season, and they wasted no time, whereas the Owl House decided to stick in some filler. And it's not just the one season, but they just wasted a ton of time, and they should have known better. And so, I think that's the biggest takeaway, is that you're not always gonna get everything that you think you're gonna get. You're not gonna always get that 4-season show. Maybe you're only gonna get 2 seasons, or 3 seasons. Plan ahead! Set up the things early on, so that if you have to cut out a big chunk of the story, it can just be third-party material, and the rest of the stuff will flow on narratively. And the Owl House just couldn't do that.